Now this photo here, this is probably the most important take-home message for people who are looking at the option of the unicompartmental knee arthroplasty. They have to point to where the pain is. If a person has global knee pain, then consider a total knee arthroplasty. Do not consider a unicompartmental knee arthroplasty. So what are the contraindications? Inflammatory arthropathy, previous HTO, cruciate ligament lesion, medial lateral subluxation, and also significant deformities. The relative contraindications, patellofemoral joint arthritis, obesity, I'd probably put it greater than 35 BMI, chondrocalcinosis, and crystalline arthropathy. With regard to imaging, it's important that weight-bearing views are taken, Rosenberg, lateral views, but also I think more importantly now with the advent of the MRI scan, this is helping us to assess the upper compartments much more definitively. And then in my practice, I believe arthroscopic assessment is also very helpful in making that decision. Now with regard to surgical technique, I've just got a short clip here and we'll just give that, she's only asked about 8 minutes. So here we are, the incision's relatively short, about 3 to 4 inches long, depending on the size of the patient. It's a medial parapatellar approach. The fat pad is then excised, as well as the anterior third of the medial meniscus. And then a portion of the MCL to gain good access. Bone nibblers used to remove the osteophytes. And this is the tibial jig. This is for a fixed unicompartmental knee arthroplasty, which is placed with the knee in extension. In fact, I put it in flexion sometimes. And importantly, the jig has to be centered. So centered over the intercondylar notch area. So once the tibial jig has been placed in, the transverse tibial cut is made. Screws are removed. And then clearance is made of the intercondylar area by removing the osteophytes from the lateral part of the medial femoral condyle. The reciprocating saw is then used to cut out the vertical cut and then to finish off the horizontal or transverse cut. And then the knee's put in extension and the tibial, resected tibial portion is removed. A spacer block is then put in, not too tightly, and this will allow the surgeon to make the definitive femoral cut. So the cutting block is then screwed in situ, and the saw cut made through the distal part of the femoral condyle. Cutting jigs removed, and the knee then is flexed, and the distal femoral cut completed. And then the flexion extension gap is assessed to ensure that it's not too tight. This is the extension gap being assessed. And the important thing is here that one doesn't overcorrect. And this here is an assessment of the flexion gap. And you can see there's very little soft tissue resection to get the balance right. This is the femoral cutting block jig, which is then screwed in situ. Aligned correctly. Drill holes made for the component. And then the saw cuts, the definitive saw cuts are made for the femoral component. Here is the preparation for the tibial portion where two drill holes are made. This is an assessment with the two components put in, the trial components put in, with the 10mm spacer. The surgeon will then determine whether it's too tight or too loose. And as I pointed out, it's important to be focused on undercorrection rather than overcorrection, because if you overcorrect, you end up putting stress in the lateral compartment. So you can see there's quite a bit of movement going on, which means it's not too tight. So this is the definitive preparation for the tibial component. Two drills are made in the tibial, resected tibial plateau. Components are then cemented in. Tibial component initially. And then the femoral component. Once the cement is cured, then the definitive plastic liner is inserted. Here it's a trial to ensure that it's not too tight. Check that all the cement has been removed, or excess cement. And this is the definitive polyethylene inserted. So that's an outline, a short outline of the technique. Right, two case studies I just want to put for you. Case study one, 69-year-old female who had a previous successful unicompartmental arthroplasty and complained of medial compartment knee pain. This is an x-ray showing a moderate degree of medial compartment osteoarthritis in the left knee, and the x-ray showing the previous unicompartmental. Now, interestingly, if you look at the MRI scan, it shows that, in fact, she has pretty well complete articular cartilage loss in that medial compartment. So she went ahead with surgery, and then 1 month post-op, she was walking without with the right elbow crutch, no analgesics, good range of movement, and was able to strengthen knee grades. And I think for those surgeons involved in knee joint arthroplasty, having a knee fully extended within a short period of time following surgery is one of the more difficult things the patient has to do. And these are definitive x-rays showing the unicompartmental in situ. This is the second case, the case that I just did before I came here to India, a 74-year-old retired farmer who complained of not medial pain, but complained of global knee pain. And if you look at the x-ray, it has unicompartmental osteoarthritis affecting the medial side. But because of the fixed flexion deformity and global knee pain, I proceeded with the total knee arthroplasty. So a unicompartmental knee joint arthroplasty is not for everyone. It's very strict criterion, and they need to be adhered to if this is going to be a successful procedure. So with regard to the outcomes, this is a typical New Zealand farming scene. The UKA appears to result in early to medium term follow-up with better patient satisfaction, function, and also lower morbidity. For those who may have had a knee joint replacement, morbidity related with having surgery to the knee is a painful, painful procedure. And Manjanath will tell me that none of this patients he doesn't want to see for a few days after because it's such a painful procedure. However, for unicompartmental knee arthroplasty, the pain is so much lower. And typically we'll start walking comfortably within a day or two. Now, with comparison to high tibia osteotomy, results of UKA favour are much better overall. Broughton and et al. Had 76% good excellent outcomes with UKA compared to a group of osteotomy cases where the good excellent outcomes are 43%. Comparing to total knee arthroplasty, the outcome with the unicompartmental, as I pointed out earlier, less pain, more stability, better stair climbing. Now, this is a study that a colleague of mine gave at the recent combined Australian-New Zealand meeting we had in Port Douglas last month. And what he did is compare three groups of patients. One had total knee joint replacement, the other uni, and the other a high tibia ostomy. But note the age, under 55. And this is the demographics of the study group. There were 75 who had a tibia osteotomy, proximal tibia osteotomy. There were 95 with the uni, and a smaller number, and one of the criticisms of this paper, of total knee joint arthroplasty. Now, if you look at the revision-free survival, total knee and unicompartmental were very similar, but you can see there with the high tibia osteotomy, most were having further surgery within about 6 years. Now, this is an interesting graph here which shows the outcome measures for patients who have a high tibia osteotomy, total knee, and unicompartmental. The forgotten joint score, a normal joint is 100, and with the high tibia osteotomy, they realised that they had had surgery, had a low score of 20, whilst those with a total knee arthroplasty, it was 40. And when you look at a total hip arthroplasty, which is the gold standard that we all look to, the forgotten joint score is generally about 54. And what is a unicompartmental? 65, or 66, much higher. So the conclusions of their study were that with a total knee arthroplasty, there was a low activity profile, moderate level of awareness of the knee joint, whilst with the unicompartmental, there was a higher activity profile and very low level of awareness of the knee joint. A study where the Oxford, which is a mobile bearing unicompartmental knee, the Oxford 3 versus a total knee arthroplasty, and this is an interesting study, although short-term, five-year follow-up that just came out recently, 168 patients that had unicompartmental knee arthroplasties and 170 with total knee arthroplasties. And look at these results. There were 6 total knee arthroplasties that were revised and 3 unicompartmentals that were revised. MUA of the total in the arthroplasty, there were 16, 8.5%. None in the unicompartmental knee group. And the knee function overall for the unicompartmental was much higher than for total knee arthroplasty. So their conclusions were fewer manipulations and higher functional outcomes for patients treated with unicompartmental compared to total knee arthroplasty. And the total knee arthroplasty had twice the revision rate, which is somewhat unusual, as the UKA, although this was not significant. Now, another interesting study, which I think one needs to be aware of, is when a patient has had a unicompartmental in one knee and a total in the other. And here again, they're looking at satisfaction. 11 expressed no preference for either knee, but 12 of this group, 50%, preferred the unicompartmental knee arthroplasty. No patient preferred the total knee arthroplasty over the unicompartmental. My personal experience, if you're looking at total knee arthroplasties, I've had three revisions with 373 knees, Oxford score 37 out of 48, which is the New Zealand average. 34 and above is seen as being a good, excellent outcome. Well, if you look at the unicompartmental arthroplasty, fixed bearing, we've had two revisions out of 104, and then looking at the Oxford score, in fact, it's 41.5 over 48. New Zealand average is 39. So significant difference when you're looking just at the outcome with respect to the Oxford score. Now, with regard to failure mechanism, because this is, I think, what all surgeons want to know, what is the main failure mechanism? And early on, understandably, it was all related to the component loosening. And the registries are picking this up. And the reason was for this was because of poor patient selection. So there were patients that, in fact, were having inflammatory arthritides that were having unicompartmental knee arthroplasties. And then because of also poor technique, component loosening was the main reason. But this has now shifted. So the main reason for failure mechanism today is actually lateral compartment osteoarthritis that progresses in time. And some of the studies here, that one of Glow in 2003, showed that there was progression of arthritis in the uninvolved compartment in revision cases in 51% of the cases. And Emerson, in a recent study in 2016, results of Oxford UK in the USA, where they looked at 213 UKAs in 173 patients with a mean, a good follow-up of 10 years. And they had a survivorship of 88% and 159 excellent post-op scores, with 6 good, 5 fair. But there were 20 that were revised. And of that group of 20, 8 had progressed to lateral compartment osteoarthritis. So progression to lateral compartment osteoarthritis is always a concern. Now, with regard to the debate of fixed versus mobile bearing UKAs, there's really no statistical significant difference between the groups. So in summary, Mr. Chairman, the unicompartmental arthroplasty continues to evolve. However, still only 4-8% of total knee arthroplasties. Outcome and revision rates for mobile and fixed bearing UKAs are similar. The commonest cause for failure is progression of lateral compartment osteoarthritis, and the outcomes for unicompartmental knee arthroplasty are generally better compared to total knee arthroplasty for rehab, function and pain in the short to medium term, but less, I believe, with respect to survivorship. So in conclusion, successful unicompartmental knee arthroplasty will occur if there's adherence to strict indications and appropriate patient selection, and also combined with meticulous surgical technique. And I think here the main focus should be on under-correction. And only then, I believe, will long-term survivorship be possibly similar to total knee arthroplasty. Knowing full well that total knee joint arthroplasty survivorship is actually better than total hip joint arthroplasty. And I believe large and long-term follow-up studies obviously needed to determine any true clinical survivorship difference between the two. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for a very, very informative presentations which were well supported by live surgical clips, easier for the understanding. So, requesting the audience if any questions or any clarification is required, so we can have the question answer sessions before moving towards our second session. So, mic please. So, anybody have questions, please do ask. Yes, sir. Mic is there.
Sir, in case of unicompartmental OA with an angular deformity more than 15 degrees, you will proceed with a total knee or a height knee will can be done?
In that situation, when the deformity is significant, would we go straight to a total knee arthroplasty?
Not high table.
If it's a younger patient, early 40s, we'll consider a high tibial osteotomy. But certainly we won't be looking at unicompartmental knee arthroplasty in that situation. So I think the take-home message with the unicompartmental knee arthroplasty is that there are strict criteria and they need to be adhered to. And if you don't adhere to them, you will have failures. And I think the other important thing from my point of view, from my practice, is that arthroscopic assessment of the knee prior to proceeding with the surgery is also helpful in determining what that lateral compartment is like. Do you have an intact lateral meniscus? Is the articular cartilage itself intact as well? Because even then, sometimes the MRI scan won't pick it up. And I think the other point is, the patient has to point to where the pain is. And so in answer to your question, you may have a patient who fulfills all the criteria, but if they've got a significant deformity, then you can't then be going ahead with the unicompartmental. A total knee would be the way to go forward.
Mr. Speaker? I would like to ask that most of the osteoarthritis in the knee are, to start with, it is a medial arthritis, but later on, it involves the whole joint, medial, lateral, and as well as metatarsophemoral. Most of our patients, but specifically for a medial joint arthritis, to label it should be benefited by the unicompartmental knee. It should be thoroughly investigated in the form of MR or arthroscope. And
all the investigations, because the demand of the patient is very high. If you do surgery in, as your slide was pointing to me, 74-year retired farmer want to replace the knee, and that too is only medial compartment. And that is, I should be very amazed, because in 74, the general health is not supporting. And most of the time in at the age of 74, already those patients are gone to the triple arthritis. Your comment, please.
Yeah, well, in our practice, I've said with the past 120 that I've already done, I've only got one out of that 120 that have progressed to lateral compartment osteoarthritis. And that's with a good follow-up. So I think you know, there's always that concern. That is the concern I have. Is this the person who's going to proceed to lateral compartment osteoarthritis? And I disagree with you with saying that with medial compartment osteoarthritis, that will necessarily progress to lateral compartment osteoarthritis. In our practice anyway, with our population, we tend to have a population where if it is medial compartment osteoarthritis, the lateral compartment well preserved, that if we do it unicompartmental, that lateral compartment holds up. It doesn't progress to lateral compartment osteoarthritis. But it's still a concern, and don't get me wrong, that's what we're looking for, and that's, I think, the evolution of we need to work out what is the best case, what is the best indication for unicompartmental. I think the take-home message I want to get across to you all is that total knee arthroplasty has a high morbidity. One out of five patients are not happy with their knee joint. How can we improve that? We can improve it with an alternative, which is the unicompartmental. Now, you may do a unicompartmental on a 50-year-old. That may need to be revised 15 years later. But for 15 years, he has had a joint which has been relatively normal. But if you did a total knee in that person at 50, then he's got a knee which, 1 out of 5 or 20% chance, he is not going to be happy with.
Now, I confess that as a non-surgeon, I'm very poorly qualified to ask this question. But still, as a person who sees lots of patients, I'd like to simply ask you, when is the stage at which in patients who have a medial meniscus tear, when you decide that no, this is not amenable simply to meniscectomy and it needs a unicompartmental surgery?
Right. Well, that's an interesting question because there's a lot of debate over the medial compartment degenerative knee. When there's often a degenerative medial meniscal tear, should we arthroscope them or not? And when you look at the literature, we shouldn't actually be scoping them at all, because there have been studies showing that if you do a sham operation on one group of patients compared to the other group, where you actually do meniscectomy and also chondroplasty, that the results are no different. So the feedback coming back to us as surgeons is that, look, with a degenerative medial meniscal tear, with degenerative medial compartment osteophytes, arthroscopic surgery is not going to help. So we, in that situation, I will say to the patient, if the symptom's not bad, look, take an anti-inflammatory, possibly a cortisone injection, and then hold off as long as possible till the definitive procedure. And the main driver will be pain. And that should be the main reason. It's not, and obviously the imaging is important. And then if pain is waking a person at night time and it's affecting their daily activities, stair climbing, doing their work and everything else, and also with the amount of walking that they can only do, then one can consider possibly a unicompartmental knee arthroplasty if they fulfill the criterion, and if not, then a total knee joint replacement. But the beauty about the unicompartmental is that you then have a procedure which has a much lower morbidity, much better recovery, much higher patient satisfaction than if you go ahead with a total knee, where 1 out of 5 patients will be dissatisfied.
A supplementary question. There are some patients who report that they're going to centers where they put in stem cells in the knee joint arthroscopy. What do you comment about that?
Yeah, all I can say is that I think if you already have degenerative arthritis within the knee joint, it's a progressive problem, and I don't think stem cell injections are going to reverse that at all, because the fact that it's a dynamic weight-bearing joint. It may be different for a non-weight-bearing joint like a shoulder, but for a weight-bearing joint, when you're putting 4 times your weight, every time you put weight on that side of the joint, I don't believe stem cell, but that's anecdotal, and that's based on pure logic. But I personally don't think that there's a role. I think stem cell, if it's going to be effective, would have to be given incredibly early on in the problem related to osteoarthritis.
This is the last question, and then we will move towards our second session.
What a nice talk given by you. My only one query about your uni knee is, have you got any idea about the survivability of revision total knee after UK or a primary
TK? Yeah, that's a very good question. And then that would be the other argument that surgeons make for not doing unicompartmental, is the question an issue with regard to revision surgery. Looking at the studies, particularly from the Oxford School in the UK, the revision to a total knee, their results have been good. But then when you look at other centres, results haven't been that good. So it's very difficult to say. However, the the take-home message with regard to revision is that when you're doing a revision from a uni to a total knee, you must always have stemmed implant ready. You must have a revision set ready. You're not going to go ahead and just do a total knee. There's a possibility you have to do a full revision with stem implants. And that's important. But I think it is a very valid point. And I think when it comes to revision, it's important when you, as the primary surgeon for doing unicompartmental replacement, that the amount of bone that you resect in the medial side should be to the minimum. You're not resecting a significant amount. And when you actually resect a small amount of that medial compartment, then when the revision date comes, hopefully it'll then just go straight to a total knee rather than to a revision implant.
As this revision surgery in a flexed knee, has it something to do with the final outcome, either it is uni knee or a total knee? The flexion deformity of a knee, has it something to do if you do a uni knee or a...
The reason why we don't tend to go ahead with like the case that I gave, the second case, is that you cannot correct that fixed flexion deformity when you're doing unicompartmental. Whilst with a total knee you can, with a uni you can't. And hence you then get eccentric wear bearing on that unicompartment. So we're quite strict on that. So if it's 15 degrees or more, then go straight to a total knee joint replacement.
Thank you.